A couple of days ago at the Realise Health Innovations conference here in Canberra, the guys from SafeMate Australia put up this slide. And I think it's really indicative of one of the questions we need to ask ourselves about communicating with emergency services going forward. To do so, I think it's a really good idea to have a look at where we've been first. So let's go back into the police box from London. Alexander Graham Bell invented the telephone in the 1870s. Approximately 20 years later, the first coast-to-coast telephone network was introduced to America. In the 1930s, the police call box was deployed through some cities in America, and the idea was then imported to Britain. Behind here was a door. You open it up, telephone for the public to be able to call for the police to attend. Access to the police box was only for police. Communication systems have changed consistently, but it seems to be about every 40 years there's some sort of innovation. So from the evolution of the police box becomes the phone booth, and from the phone booth becomes, well, this kind of phone booth. In the 70s, this was still quite new. So from the 70s, let's jump forward 40 years, and that brings us to today. So how do we communicate with the emergency services now? Let's be realistic. Most of the time, it's still by picking up a telephone and ringing 911 999 000. It varies from country to country. Remembering back in England, it used to be ringing a particular phone number, and that's one of the reasons why on the phone number call thing that it says what the police phone number is, although now it's one national number. Mobile phones have become one of the key ways of communicating with emergency services. Far more convenient, it's in your pocket, there it is. Pick up the phone, dial. And yet, why are we phoning? We have social media now, we have Twitter, we have Facebook, we have LinkedIn, we have Snapchat, we have all these other devices that we can use. And many of these have been used in disaster situations before to communicate with emergency services. This report by the UN from 2012 reinforces that point. So going forward, how are we going to use it? If we use Twitter to communicate with emergency services now, who's really listening? You pick up the phone, you talk to someone right away. You tweet a request, who's going to get it? How is emergency services going to process that information, particularly if you have location services turned off on your telephone? Facebook has been used multiple times in disaster situations, but often this is more a communication of I need help soon or we need help here, not in an emergency situation. When the big one actually does happen, is someone going to be sitting at a computer looking at Facebook Messenger to see who in the community is communicating with the emergency services via Facebook Messenger? Who's going to be going through the thousands of tweets about the disaster? We can have filtration devices to actually sieve out some of that information, but realistically, this massive amount of data is going to be coming down on emergency services, and they're going to be busy looking after other things. Very soon, these will not exist. And there's potential that the 000 network, the 911 network, will be evolving into something completely different.